In this video, we're talking about the octet rule, ionic compounds, and molecules, or sometimes called covalent compounds. So first, the octet rule. The octet rule says that atoms will gain or lose electrons so as to have the same number of valence electrons as the nearest noble gas. Well, when I say nearest noble gas, I mean in terms of atomic number. So the noble gas whose atomic number is closest to whatever element we're talking about, that's the noble gas, the nearest noble gas. For example, the nearest noble gas to sodium is the previous element in the periodic table. Remember, we read left to right, top to bottom, and that's neon. So neutral sodium's electron configuration is 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s1. It has one valence electron. Well, neon's electron configuration is 1s2, 2s2, 2p6. It has 8 valence electrons. Remember, highest level, 2. There's 2 here and 6 here. That's 8. Whereas this 3s1 is sodium's. So what sodium does is it loses its 3s electron, and now it has the same electron configuration, which means the same number of valence electrons as neon when it's the cation, sodium plus 1. We lose this one electron, it's 1s2, 2s2, 2p6. Which is why all of the alkali metals will lose one electron to be like the nearest noble gas, and have always in ionic compounds will have a plus 1 charge. The alkaline earth metals, the second column, will lose 2 electrons for it to have a plus 2 charge and be like the nearest noble gas. This is also why the halogens will gain one electron to be like the nearest noble gas and form an anion with a negative 1 charge. So chlorine's electron configuration is neon 3s2 3p5. 7 valence electrons, 2 plus 5 is 7. The nearest noble gas to chlorine is argon. So if we look at the periodic table here, there's chlorine, there's argon, that's the nearest noble gas. Whereas before, there's sodium, atomic number 11. Neon, atomic number 10, is the nearest noble gas, not argon. So, but here, chlorine, argon has 8 valence electrons. So chlorine's gonna gain one to have the same electron configuration and thus the same number of valence electrons as argon, the nearest noble gas. Argon's electron configuration is neon 3s2 3p6, 8 valence electrons. So chlorine will tend to gain one electron when it's in a compound and have the electron configuration neon 3s2 3p6, just like argon, and 8 valence electrons. So everything in this column, the halogens, tend to gain one to be like the nearest noble gas, and that means they will have a negative 1 charge. This column, at least up until we get to the metalloids, will tend to gain 2, have a negative 2. This up to here, maybe here, will gain 3 for a negative 3. Metals, because the nearest noble gas for all the metals is the previous noble gas, metals all lose electrons in compounds, whereas nonmetals tend to gain electrons when they're combined with metals. So a metal combined with a nonmetal, which is an ionic compound, the metal will lose one or more electrons, the nonmetal will gain one or more electrons. So if we look at the Lewis symbols, the dot symbols for sodium, remember each dot represents one valence electron. Sodium has one valence electron when it's neutral, there it is. Chlorine, when it's neutral, has 7 valence electrons. So it's pretty easy, I think, to look at this and see that in order to have 8 valence electrons, like the nearest noble gas, chlorine needs one more. And if sodium loses this, it'll have the previous noble gas's electron configuration. So what happens is this one electron, when chlorine and sodium come together, sodium releases its electron, chlorine grabs it, and now sodium, because it lost an electron, has a plus 1 charge. Chloride gained an electron, has a negative 1 charge. We get sodium chloride. This is an ionic compound, a metal and a nonmetal. And what happened is the metal lost an electron, the nonmetal gained an electron, the metal became a cation, the nonmetal became an anion. Now what holds this ionic compound together are the opposite charges. Opposite electric charges attract each other. So the positive charge here and the negative charge here attract each other, holding the sodium ion and the chloride ion together, making an ionic bond. with aluminum oxide, if we bring an aluminum with oxygen together, each aluminum has three valence electrons. It's a metal. It's going to want to lose all three. Each oxygen has six valence electrons. It wants to gain two. All right, well, if we take two of the electrons from this aluminum and put them on this oxygen's happy. It's satisfied the octet rule. But this aluminum is not happy. It still has one electron it needs to get rid of. So it gives it to another oxygen atom. But that oxygen atom still needs one more electron. So it goes up to another aluminum atom, grabs one of those electrons. Now, this aluminum and both of these oxygens are happy, meaning they've satisfied the octet rule. But this aluminum still has two more valence electrons. Remember, it gave this one over here. So it gives these two to another atom of oxygen. Now, this atom has eight valence electrons. This aluminum has lost all three valence electrons. Everybody satisfied the octet rule. Each aluminum has a plus three charge. Each oxide ion has a negative two charge. Notice we have six negative charges, six positive charges. They balance. We write this normally as Al2O3, aluminum oxide. Now, when two non-metal atoms come together, they're still trying to satisfy the octet rule. The difference is that neither one of them is going to either pull the electrons strongly enough to pull them away from the other atom, or neither one's going to really release them. So what they do is they share electrons. For example, if we bring two fluorine atoms together, you can see each fluorine needs one more electron to satisfy the octet rule. And neither one is strong enough to pull the electron away from the other atom, so what they do is they share. They share one of their valence electrons. This fluorine shares this one, this fluorine shares this one. And now we have these two electrons that are seen by both and felt by both of the atoms. So you see this fluorine atom here feels or sees 2, 4, 6, 8 valence electrons. It sees both of these as belonging to it. And so does this atom. It sees 8 valence electrons. Both of the atoms are happy. The octet rule is satisfied. And now when we do that, when we share electrons, most of the time we write it as a line rather than the dots. And one line represents two electrons. And if it's just one line like this or just two dots shared, we call that a single bond. It's a covalent bond. Covalent means that the electrons are being shared. Normally we omit the term covalent, just say a single bond, but it's not wrong to say single covalent bond because that's what it really is. If we bring two oxygen atoms together, each oxygen you see needs two more valence electrons. And so if this oxygen shares this one, and this oxygen shares this one, and this oxygen shares this one, and this oxygen shares this one, what happens is we get a double covalent bond, a double bond. Now look, this oxygen here sees or feels 2, 4, 6, 8 valence electrons. Remember, each line is two electrons. And so does this atom, 2, 4, 6, 8. Both atoms have the octet rule satisfied, and we formed what's called a double bond. Two nitrogen atoms come together. Each nitrogen needs three more electrons to have eight, to be like the nearest noble gas. And so what happens is each will share three valence electrons, form a triple bond, and each nitrogen atom sees 2, 4, 6, 8 valence electrons. The octet rule is satisfied, and we formed a triple bond. There are some exceptions to the octet rule, and you should memorize them. Hydrogen, well, it's not really an exception. It does satisfy the octet rule. But the nearest noble gas to hydrogen is helium, which only has two valence electrons. But I put it up here just so you'll memorize it. So hydrogen can only have two valence electrons at most. And it tends to want two valence electrons. Beryllium, now it's different, it's kind of weird. It will have four valence electrons, and that's it. Not eight, not two. And boron will have six valence electrons, not eight. I'll show you some examples in just a moment. Now the other exception, which is really huge, is that if you're any element that's in the third row of the periodic table or lower, that's this one starting with sodium, magnesium, aluminum, silicon, all these guys, and lower, any of these elements here, they can have more than 8 valence electrons when they're in a compound. And they can have 10, they can have 12, or they could have 14. They could have 8, 10, 12, or 14, and still be stable, or like we call it, happy. So for example, hydrogen, H2, the octet rule really is satisfied. This oxygen sees two, these two valence electrons. In beryllium chloride, this is actually the form that this molecule takes. The beryllium atom sees 2, 4 electrons. That's it. We don't form double bonds here, even though we could. And each chlorine sees 2, 4, 6, 8. And that's the structure. Beryllium has 4 valence electrons in its compounds. Boron, this is boron trifluoride. This is the structure. 3 single bonds here. The boron sees 2, 4, 6. If we formed a double bond with one of these forons, it would give it 8, but it doesn't. Just remember that boron forms compounds with 6 valence electrons, not 8. And this is one of the many examples of the compounds and the elements in the third row or lower that have more than 8 valence electrons. This is sulfur hexafluoride, and it has 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12 valence electrons. It has 6 fluorine atoms attached to the central sulfur.